Welcome to the Bible Study Hour. We are so pleased to be able to join you in this very beautiful study that we have for this week. We have been studying for the entire quarter a topic which is very meaningful to us, rest in Christ. Because if there's ever a time when we realize that we really need rest, it's now. There is so much that is attacking us on every side to weary us out, that we really need this rest in Christ. And the topic that we are doing for this week is one that repeats itself every now and again. And last week we had much of it, but to show how important it is, we bring it back this week in the fashion of Sabbath rest. As you get your lesson guide ready, and if you don't have that, your Bible, of course, as we go through the Bible Study Hour, we will be prepared to discuss this with an open mind and with the understanding of the benefits that are hidden in it for us. We will search for them, we will look for them, and we will make good use of them. We are happy to have sharing with us this week two persons. One you have met in this fashion before. On my right, we have Pastor Alden Mort. We have had him over and over again, and we are happy to have him this week with us. On my left, we have Elder Albert Morris. Elder Morris operates as an elder of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Sandy Bay, Hanover. And we are so happy to have him sharing with us this week. And together with me, Lorna Stevenson, we will go through this lesson as best as we can to guide us into the truths that are embedded there. We pause here to say thanks to our sponsors, Easy Deal Auto Sales and Tours Limited, located at 1139 Catherine Hall, Montego Bay. And you may get them on the telephone at 371-2804. Thanks to all those who have made it possible for us to meet in this fashion for this study. But you know we say special thanks to God, and that is why before we open God's Word to do the study, we invite God's presence in our midst, and we now invite you to join us in our opening prayer.
Let us talk to our friend and Savior. Our great eternal Father and our God, it is our joy to come into your presence, asking you for your divine assistance. We come now and we ask you that you will give us the Holy Spirit, so that even as we spin your word and we examine it, you will give us the right understanding. Bless the viewers. Bless all of us as we study your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen.
Amen. Our topic, Sabbath rest. Is there anything in the word Sabbath that really means rest? I think so. Yes. So it's almost as if we are saying rest, rest,
rest, rest.
Yes.
Yes.
And as we look at this, we will look at our chief text, which we refer to as our memory text, and that's Leviticus chapter 23, verse 3. It says in the New King James Version, Six days shall work be done, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of solemn rest, a holy convocation. You shall do no work on it. It is the Sabbath of the Lord in your dwellings. There are several pointers that we have in this one little text. Yes. And maybe, gentlemen, you will want to at least point out at least one of them each.
Yes. When you look at the memory text, you see, God is specific. He tells us what to do.
Yes.
And he says, 6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of solemn rest. And so here you see that God, who is our maker, declared to us that he's going to give us 6 days to work. But when it comes on to the seventh one, that is a Sabbath. No, that is a Sabbath. And that day does not belong to you to work. It is a day of rest. And should I say worship also?
Well, that's a part of the rest, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes. I want to underscore in the text, in all your dwellings, and in continuation with Pastor Moore said, wherever we are, wherever we live, whatever dispensation, it is still applicable.
Yes.
Very much applicable that the Sabbath be kept, be observed, wherever, in all your dwellings, whoever we are. I would just want to point that out as an importance.
Beautiful. And I think it would also add to the richness of the situation.
Yes.
If you had put a little light, beam a little light on that little statement which comes just before that. It is the Sabbath of the Lord in all your dwellings.
Yes.
And I never lose an opportunity to share this with anyone I have this sort of a discussion, that we are not to think that we have a Sabbath.
No, we don't.
Because the Sabbath is a Sabbath of the Lord.
Yes.
And if we focus on that some more, I think we will have a better understanding of what this Sabbath idea is all about.
Because even when Jesus came on earth, he reiterated that premise.
Yes.
That the Sabbath doesn't belong to man, but he is Lord of the Sabbath. Even in his action, it says very clear that it continues, not just an Old Testament situation, but right into the New Testament, which serves as example for all living beings in whatever dispensation.
Thank you. And Pastor?
You see, even in the Sabbath and the commentary section, it highlights the fact that, you see, God is specific. You know, the seventh, the seventh day. And so therefore, it cannot be any other day. It is not my Sabbath, as Ella says. It's not, you know, it is not what I want to do.
Right.
You know, it is God who dictates to us what to do on the Sabbath. And so there are some, you know, I don't want to say flimsy excuse that, you know, Jesus changed the Sabbath. The, you know, when Jesus died, you know, in the resurrection, that is the Sabbath. God was specific, and God tells us which day is the Sabbath. It is.
Thank you very much. Now, as we continue our study for this week, we are looking at the link that we have between the Sabbath and creation.
Oh, yes.
So, we have some passages on which we will focus. We look to Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27.
I shared, Styx. Verse 26 of Genesis chapter 1, 27 says, "And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them.
Okay. And we are going to look at this also against the passage that we have in Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 and 19.
And the word of God says, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. Verse 19, and out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and the fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof.
Wow.
We are seeing in this section of our study then, not only a link with creation, but also a matter of relationships and the importance of mankind relating to God and relating to creation in general.
Right.
Okay. Now, let us focus a little bit on what we read in Genesis chapter 1. What's the emphasis that we are seeing there?
As we look at the text, we realize that God created human beings, male and female, and there's a special bonding from beginning with God and mankind. And in that relationship, it's part of his creation, which he says is good, and is still good even though marred by sin. And he's still interesting in human beings. That is one of the key points I want to bring out right now.
Good. So there is something very special about humankind.
Yes.
It's very, very special. Although everything that God did at creation was special, creating man was extra special.
It was.
Extra special. And there is something, I think you want to say something on this, Pastor, but hold it and put it together with the next stage of the discussion, which we are saying there's something about man's responsibility that even adds to how special he really was to God and is still to God. Pastor.
Is it when you look, you know, as Ella said, that man was special. Man was created in the image of God. So therefore man is not like the ape or the lion. There's a special category that, you know, that is given to man. So man is created into God's image. And so even as the Genesis 2 says that when God created the animals and from the dust of the earth, he brought it to Adam and said, Adam, name it.
Name
them. Name them. And Adam would give the name. So you see that, you know, the stage that Adam was, he was in, put it this way, a higher category than the animals. And so therefore, even when you look at the connection with the Sabbath, you see, God gave the Sabbath to man. Man was special. Man was, you know, created in the image. So God gave the Sabbath to them, and, you know, either put it this way, you know, as somebody said, God was not tired when he created the Sabbath.
No.
Mm-mm. He was there, he gave it as a gift, and he worshiped man on the Sabbath day.
Could we dare say as well that when man first experienced the Sabbath, man wasn't tired either?
Yeah.
No, man was not tired.
All right.
I looked at it, sister. I know you get it to a point. I look at it, and I'm seeing a principle here set by God for allegiance in the intelligence and intellect that God would have created mankind before sin, as Adam and Eve. And so that kind of reasoning would allow mankind to say, in the likeness, when I say this is a cat, for example, God is in agreement. And so the principle of rest comes in where he wants mankind now to focus and relate to him. I know we're going to get a little bit deeper in it, but on the surface in it, wants mankind to be in a connection with him. So he relax, he have a day where, hey, this is, it's like my wedding day. It is special. Nothing else should disturb it. I know we get into it further.
And sure enough, as God gave man assignments, responsibility, those are the things that you are to work on as you go along through the week and enjoy doing it too.
Exactly.
Have a great time doing it. But when it comes to the Sabbath, listen, take your mind off those things and come now, let us spend time together. It's interesting. You mentioned earlier on about celebrating. And that's what we're going to talk about a little bit now.
Yes.
Celebrating freedom. Celebrating freedom. I think the idea of celebrating freedom comes to us now because we're talking about rest.
Yes.
And if you are enslaved, and you are set free, then it means now that you are really having good reason to celebrate.
To celebrate, mm-hmm. Yes.
Let us look at some of these passages to which the study points us at this time. We're looking at Genesis chapter 4, verse 7, and then Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, also 2 Peter. Let's start with Genesis 4.
So Genesis 4, verse 7 says, "If thou dost well, shall thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him."
Mm-hmm. Hebrews?
Hebrews 12, verse 1. "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight, and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us."
Okay, and we want to look also at 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 19, which says, "While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought in bondage." Some of these passages sound kind of a sophisticated, but if you look at them closely, you'll see how straightforward they are in what they are saying. Mm-hmm. Let's start our comments.
Yes.
The first passage that was read spoke of an incident in Genesis.
Right.
And maybe we'll want to start there. Let's start there, because we are going to be looking now at this whole matter of celebrating freedom.
Yes.
Basically,
you want to start? Yes.
Yes. Basically, if you even started from Genesis chapter 3, where sin came in the fall, with Cain and Abel, come right over, looking at Cain and Abel, or Cain mm-hmm. descendants, we see here where sin would have entered the mm-hmm. world. And it would point out that if thou doest well, if thou move from out of sin, thou shalt be accepted. But if we live in sin, sin will stay at our door.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, if we enslave ourselves to sin,
mm-hmm.
it's going to be our master.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to bond us in that sort of a situation.
Mm-hmm.
What the last phrase says, "Unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him." I just explained it, but just going further.
Yes.
If sin is controlled, controls our life rather,
mm-hmm.
we are going to live in it.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, we won't be freed from it. And in living in it, it's not just in its action, but affects our mental being.
Yes. Yes.
Our mental being. Okay. I'm sure Pastor might want to add to this also.
I'm sure he's going to.
Go ahead, Pastor. One of the things is that even as I look at the text, you know, the connection with freedom and the Sabbath.
Mm-hmm.
If you go to Deuteronomy, let me start with Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy set the stage, and you see Deuteronomy 12 says, you know, remember the Sabbath to keep the Sabbath to sanctify it as the Lord thy God has commanded thee. But when it reached down to 15, look what God says.
Yes.
"Remember that thou was a what? A slave in the land of where? Egypt. And that the Lord thy God brought thee out hence through a mighty hand and by a stretched out hand. So therefore, the Lord thy God commanded thee to keep the Sabbath day." So here, when you look at Israel, Israel was in bondage. And God says, "Listen, remember, you know, that you were in bondage. And that's why I am giving the Sabbath to you, to realize that, you know, to make you take note where you were and what I did for you. So when you come on the Sabbath, you must remember that I am your Redeemer." And the same thing with us.
Yes.
You understand? We We are born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And also the Bible says that all of us sin and come short of the glory of God. And sin leads to death. Sin leads to bondage. And so as a result of that, you know, we are all in bondage. But we give God thanks for his grace that he rescued us out of sin. So when we come on the Sabbath day and we reflect at creation, we also reflect on his redemption power, that he saved us. You understand? So the Sabbath, you know, is creation, yes, but it's also redemption.
I want to add to
Pastor. You're getting
yes.
Way down there now. But before we get there,
oh, yes.
I just want us to, you know, as it were, rub in this whole idea of sin being slavery.
Yes.
For example, Hebrews talks about laying aside
the weight.
Yes, the sin which does so easily beset us. And then when we get to Peter is saying something else to us. And, you know, his words are so pointed here, where it says, "For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought in bondage." Mm-hmm. So if we are overcome by sin, mm-hmm. we're not overcoming sin.
Right.
Sin holds us down.
Yes.
We are in bondage to sin.
Yes.
It's amazing how we are in bondage and don't even know.
And this thing, you know, as you say that bondage. So when you're in bondage, you seem like you're a slave. You can't help yourself.
Yes.
You can't help yourself.
All right, go ahead, sir.
I want to add to that too, using a little bit of analogy. Looking
yes.
even at my
yes.
age, mm-hmm. the years I've been living.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Israelites were in slavery over 50 years, hundreds of years.
Yes.
And if I'm living X amount of years, and I am in bondage, what God brought me out.
Mm-hmm.
Could imagine the celebration that I would want to be experiencing.
Yes.
Yet no, God is saying to us that we are not, and we were not in that kind of slavery. We are in a different kind of slavery. But it's showing us a point that if we allow him to take over our lives mm-hmm. and we become overcomers of sin, then we are free. And going back to the text, even if we lay it down.
You know, Elder Morris, you have started to expound on what you're going to read for us and expound some more on right now.
Yes.
Because as we go to Romans chapter 6,
yes,
we're just going to read verses 6 and 7 at this point.
Okay.
After you have read that, you can continue your...
I thank you.
Yes.
Knowing this, Romans 6, verse 6 and 7, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Some key words are used here,
yes.
Elder Pastor.
I want to provoke you a little bit before you continue. That last verse that you just read,
yes.
He that is dead.
Dead.
Everybody would find that easy to understand. Because once you're dead, you can't sin anymore.
No.
But I think you have something else to explain to us there.
This death is not a physical death. I would say not spiritual in a sense, but it is a moving away from where you're no longer knowing mm-hmm. sin and involving sin.
Yeah.
There's no mindset, because it says the dead know nothing.
Yes.
So when you're dead to something, you know not of it. You're not interested in it. I want mm-hmm. to put it that way. You are free from it. So you have no interest in it.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to go to the point also of the old man. When something is old, it's past, it becomes no more usable. And when the old man is crucified means killed, put aside. Self-sacrifice is coming here. Mm-hmm. No longer, Pastor. I want to. And I want to say this from my own testimony, that every time I am overcoming, I have overcome something of sinful nature through
yes.
the help of God.
Yes.
I feel free.
You feel light.
I feel light. And when it attacks me again, if I even should an inch touch it, I feel miserable.
Yes.
And
yes.
I want to get out of it. It
yes.
becomes uncomfortable. It has no taste to me anymore.
You know, when you put down something, when you're not eating something again, when you put it to pass, yes, it is past, it is dead, it's laid to rest. It is at the foot of the cross. It is no more burden to you. I remember growing up on the farm, carrying heavy baskets of yam and other grown provision. And when you walk along with it, it feels like the weight resting in your neck and your shoulder. And that's even so when you remove it. What
wow.
a celebration. I leave the rest here.
Yes. I like the part that he says, and Ella touched it, the old man
yes.
is crucified, listen to this, with him. I like the word with him.
Mm. Because we have a fact, when Christ, you know, was crucified on the cross, it gives us the victory.
Amen.
We are no longer slave anymore, but we are now set free in Jesus Christ. And so that is the reason why we come to him and we surrender ourselves to him, and he set us free. And that's how the imprinting of the Sabbath, the collection of the Sabbath, in celebration that we are celebrating what
Amen.
God has done for us.
Something jump at me. It's a question.
All right. Yes, brush it off. Go ahead and brush it off.
And I know we'll answer it.
Yes.
Is a celebration, will the celebration commence here on earth over sin? Or we have to wait until we get to heaven?
We better start now.
Oh, praise God.
Because if we don't start now,
yes,
then we're not going anywhere else.
Exactly.
We have to have reason to start now.
Right.
Because when Jesus has set us free, then we are free to rest in him.
Oh, yes.
And that is where we are going with our celebration.
Praise
to rest
God.
In Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, there are other things that we are reminded of that we need to pay attention to as we consider this Sabbath rest and resting in Christ that we have been studying all along. But I'm just going to say to our viewers for right now, we're taking a short break here, but stay with us. Mm-hmm. We'll be back with you in no time at all.
You are the essence of love, the love of my dream, the source of my laughter that ripples in stream. You are the perfume of roses, the lily's white.
hiciste los labios para su alabanza.
Welcome back to the Bible Study Hour. We are so glad you decided to stay with us. We are happy to have you as we continue this very beautiful study that we are having this week. And as we talk about Sabbath rest, we are now at the section of our learning, our discussion, our study, where we are focusing on the stranger in your gates. The stranger in your gates. Let's read Exodus chapter 19, verse 6.
And the word of God declares, "And he shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation." These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel.
Now, I want you to think about what was just read. Think of what we're looking at in Exodus chapter 19, verse 6. And we're going to link that now with Exodus chapter 23, verse 12.
It says, 6 days thou shalt do thy work, and on the seventh day thou shalt rest, that thine ox and thine ass may rest, and the son of thy handmaid and the stranger may be refreshed.
All right. Now, that second verse speaks more to the subtopic as we have it.
Yes.
The stranger in your gates. Mm-hmm. And someone would probably want to ask, now, where did that first verse come from? How does it come in?
Yes.
Because we're talking about God's people being a kingdom of priests. Mm-hmm. Will one of you gentlemen please bring it in for us? How do we tie that into the whole matter of the stranger in your gates?
And the Bible make it clear that even he was talking to, God was talking to Israel, but even in Peter, God is talking to us, even as followers, that we are holy people, we are, you understand. And so therefore, God is saying that, hey, if you are going to be priests, you are going to set the example within your house, because the strangers are within your gates, and you must live the life that counts. And that's why he said that you are a holy nation. And so therefore, because we are holy,
yes,
we must display it.
Amen.
And the stranger, those who come by in our gate, must realize that we are connected. And the Sabbath is also is that, you know, sign that say, hey, we are connected to God, the creator of the world, and our redeemer. So therefore, the connection is there with the Sabbath and the Sabbath, the priest, and the stranger.
And I'm
like
seeing something
tie
about
up
a stranger.
Everything. Hold on, don't go to the stranger yet.
Okay.
I want us to stay a little longer with the priest.
Yes.
Because in addition to what Pastor said about the priest and setting the example and the holiness and that kind of a thing, the priests also have a special function that would pull in the stranger within the gates.
Yes. The function I'm seeing here
is
to represent God and godliness, and in addition, to ensure that within his gates as a priest, whatever actions, whatever activity takes place is also represent godliness. Wherever there's a time for worship to be called, the priest is responsible. Where there's time to have discussion, the priest is responsible. And the list goes on.
Yes.
So the priest is now held accountable. That's one of the points I want to make. Mm-hmm. Held accountable to God for godliness within his womb.
And also, we don't want to overlook the point that one of the functions of the priest or the priesthood,
yes,
was to take the gospel to the world.
Yes. Yes.
So that it's not only to this little company that you have here that you are responsible. Mm-hmm. You know, you are pastor for this church and this is where you're responsible. No, your responsibility is to take the gospel, mm-hmm. take Jesus Christ to the world. Mm-hmm. So as such, you will include all of the strangers within Amen. Your gates.
Amen.
Go ahead.
I want to add to that. If I may go into part of a stranger.
Yes.
The priest know, even within the home, mm-hmm. whoever comes in and I see the stranger as one who has not accepted the faith mm-hmm. of, and the beliefs of the Ten Commandments. Mm-hmm. And so that stranger, whoever be biological family member or a friend or a visitor, would know the priest's responsibility in that home setting mm-hmm. to take the truth through God's love, not by force, but in a timely manner related to them. So if I am a stranger, for example, within Pastor's Gate, and I'm going to spend 6 days, I'm saying this, it might be controversial in some discussion, mm-hmm. but if Pastor, I'm staying with Pastor as a friend, as a visitor, but I'm a stranger, this pastor's responsibility to share with me first that before you get there, or even as you get there, this is the principle. This is what happens here. In the morning, this is where devotion begins. This should not is not going to be eaten. This is not going to be done. And would give me a sort of idea what happens there in love. And help me, even if I fail in my stay there, in any act of godliness, help me to understand that, hey, God still loves you even if you make a mistake.
Very good. Go ahead, Pastor.
Let me go back to Peter, because in Peter, there's a message for us.
Yes.
But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a particular people that you should show forth the what? The praises of him who have called you out of what? Darkness into his what?
Marvelous
light.
Amen.
Now, you see, as Christian, as God's children, we are connected to Jesus Christ. We have this, because we were in darkness, you know, and now we are in light.
Yes.
Now, let's look at it. If we, as a God's people, were ministering to the world in a way of love and let them see the true meaning of the Sabbath, how many would be connected to Jesus and worship him?
Not by only talking, Pastor.
By action, that's what I'm talking about.
Our action, our relation. I normally look at it and I'm learning and we're ever learning that part of my responsibility, even mm-hmm. moving along the streets mm-hmm. when I'm going to church and yes. all, is to reach out to person, let them see God representation me in mm-hmm. love just yeah. by my very smile
yes.
can be a very evangelical.
So we are saying here then that which we believe, we must believe it to the extent where we are not ashamed to share it with others, because we would want others to believe that as well.
Exactly.
So that if I am going to be a Sabbath keeper,
yes,
and I think I want to do it the right way, I really shouldn't deliberately involve others in activities that I wouldn't involve myself in.
Yes.
All right? And we are reminded here in all this that all members of the human family need the Sabbath rest as much as the few who think they have the whole knowledge of Sabbath rest.
Yes.
All members of the human family yes. need the Sabbath rest.
Yes.
Because don't forget that the Sabbath rest is time spent with God.
Amen. Amen.
And time serving others.
Whoa.
And that takes us to the next section of our study, which talks about serving others honors God's Sabbath.
Whoa. Honors
God's yes.
Sabbath.
Yes. So it seems that if we take the whole thing of all we have been studying so far
yes.
and put logic to it, we are saying that when we serve others, we spend time with God.
We do.
When we serve others, we honor God.
Yes.
Let's get an illustration of this from one of those extraordinary miracles that Jesus performed when he was here on earth. As we read John chapter 5, and we'll take verses 8 to 11 and 14 and 15.
And the word of God says, Jesus said unto him, Rise, take up thy bed and walk. Mm-hmm. And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said unto him, That was cured. It is the Sabbath day. It is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. Mm. Verse 11, he answered them, He that made me whole, the same said unto me, Take up thy bed and walk. Verse 14, afterward Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon thee. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole.
Mm. All right. Here is an encounter, a very special encounter with Jesus. And the passage from which we read makes it clear to us that this encounter took place on the Sabbath day. Mm-hmm. Now, why should this be a bother to anybody? What is it that Jesus had done there that was considered not to be done? How did the religious people see this?
The religious persons in that time was, I use a term, it's used more than once, considered to be legalistic. They were more looking at the physical activities. And so the fact of the man carrying his bed, they had laws against it. It was like too much weight. But Jesus was now pointing out to them and to the man that while I'm healing you physically, the most important thing is your spiritual life. You are now free from sin. You are now able to walk in light of newness because I've set you free from what affects you or that which was enslaving you. And so it's important to us that while we are serving others, in the service that we offer, once it brings glory to God, blessing, it offers rest and freedom from sin.
And thank you for that thought. Let me just interject here for a moment that Jesus performed many, many miracles.
Yes.
And not all of them were done on the Sabbath
not
day.
All.
And, you know, it's not that he piled them up to do them on the Sabbath day because he thought it was all right to do it on the Sabbath day. And that's why we need to be very careful that we do not pile up things to be done on the Sabbath day.
Yes.
Because we think those things are accepted because you're helping somebody, you're taking care of the sick. You leave what could have been done before to do it on the Sabbath. That's not what is happening here.
No.
And we have to be mindful of that. You know, as we are talking about this, I remember an incident that I had some long years ago. We had a Friday evening fire at the home.
Oh.
And it was really evening. It wasn't afternoon, it was evening. And the Sabbath morning found me putting out things to dry. Because luckily enough, the fire was of such that we could have done the home remedy to use water at home and, you know, put it out.
Yes.
So the Sabbath morning found me putting out things to dry. I wonder if somebody, one of those persons, those religious persons would pass by and say, Look at how she is breaking the Sabbath. Yeah. Should I have left those wet things in the house for another day? Was it a necessity then? You don't have to answer me if you don't want to. Maybe the viewers can answer, because
it could allow for thought provocation and thinking. But the answer is there.
Yes.
Because in essential, God, Jesus did not wait no long time. If you look at how the text started, he moved into that area of conversation that will take place. But in everything, to make this kind of decision, when we see things as Christians, or even not Christians, is to know what is before, or not knowing is to allow God to direct the mind and the thought.
And as we talk about that, let's see what Isaiah chapter 58, verses 12-14
is saying.
Let's see what it has to add to our discussion here.
I read, "And they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places. Thou shalt raise up the foundations of many generations, and thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in. If thou turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable, and shall honor him, not doing thine own ways, nor finding thine own pleasure, nor speaking thine own words, then shalt thou delight thyself in the Lord, and I will cause thee to ride upon the high places of the earth, and feed thee with the heritage of Jacob thy father, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it."
Yes.
What does Isaiah say that will help us know thoughts about serving others, honoring God's Sabbath?
I wanted to just comment a little.
You can always go back.
As long as
when you go back, you come forward again.
Okay. Yes. You see, many of us miss the true meaning of the Sabbath.
Amen.
Many of us. You see, we just look at the Sabbath as a day.
Burden.
And it, you know, when it comes, you know, there are certain laws that we can't do and we should not do. And so, therefore, the Sabbath becomes a depression. Can I say that?
Burden,
it's just burdensome.
Yes.
But, you see, and that's what the Jews did. They add upon the Sabbath, and they add upon the Sabbath. And there are certain things that they could not do, and they dare not to do this. And if you carry your bed, you can carry it in private, you can't do this in public. And they miss the true meaning of the Sabbath.
Yes.
You see, any time we take out Christ out of the Sabbath, we are missing the mark.
And we lose the rest.
So therefore, here Jesus, you know.
That's a good reminder that we are studying about rest in Christ.
And so therefore, you know, look at the Jews. And I'm just going to do a look. You see, they are the one. Jesus did this marvelous thing. This man was now, you know, he was carrying his bed and he was happy and he was leaving and all that. And they saw the man and questioned the man. But look at their intention. When the man told him that, you know, the man that healed me told me to carry the bag. And the man went back and said, "It is Christ." Look at what they in their thoughts on the Sabbath.
Yes.
They wanted to kill Jesus.
Whoa.
On the Sabbath. No. On the Sabbath. So you see that they miss the true purpose of the Sabbath. And so therefore, you know, you see what Isaiah tells us to do now. That the Sabbath is not for our delight.
No.
Hello?
No.
It is not for our pleasure. Mm-hmm. You see, it is for Christ. We are exalting the name of Jesus. We are uplifting him. And so therefore, to minister to others, it's our delight. And that's what Christ's delight is to touch lives.
Yes.
On the Sabbath. And that's what the Sabbath was created for, is to touch lives, is to minister, is to help somebody to see Jesus, is to help somebody, is to help the poor, the needy, to give them a bread or something like that. The Sabbath, if there's a need there out there, we must minister.
So
not because
saying,
it's on the Sabbath.
Pastor, you were talking so fast a while ago.
Yes.
That maybe you left out a word that you shouldn't have, or you put in one that you should have. Whatever it is, we're talking about delight. Yes, we're not to have our own pleasure, but the Sabbath is to be a delight.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, it must have our own pleasure, but it's a delight for us.
Because we can find that delight and joy in serving others, because we would have found the rest for ourselves already.
Yes.
Not in pleasure that relates to our own
gratification.
Gratification, right. Quite fitting word.
Mm-hmm.
But that which will now honor God.
Exactly.
And the sanctification of the Sabbath. Therefore, wherever I am, whatever I am doing, if I am not in church worshiping, I have to out there, as I say, things should not be left. But if I'm going to church, Pastor, and I'm assigned to preach a Sabbath,
or I'm assigned to do the lesser review, but I'm on my way 9 a.m. Mm-hmm. because of the distance I live and I'm driving, but I pass something happening, an accident, and somebody need to take it up, and I am training first aid, and I need to use my vehicle to assist someone, and I do that, but I have to ask somebody else not to present the word or ask it to serve some adjustment. Mm. It is quite fitting.
Yes.
But if I know from Wednesday that this was a help, but I push it aside because I said, oh, I don't have any time, and then wait until the summer, that's a danger.
That's a danger. And we are just reminded here of this strong statement which says, more than any other day of the week, Sabbath should take us out of ourselves and our own selfishness and cause us to think more about others and others' needs than about ourselves and our needs.
Straightforward, on point.
The Sabbath has so much attached to it that we are going to be looking at it now as we get near to the closing off of our study. We are going to be looking at the sign that we belong to God. The sign that we belong to God. And in looking at this subtopic as we have it here, remember, it's all in the context of Sabbath rest. It's all in that context.
Yes.
So let's see what we learn from Exodus chapter 31, verses 13, 16, 17.
Okay, I read. Speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, verily my Sabbaths ye shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am the Lord that doth sanctify you. Verse 16 and 17. Wherefore, the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations, for a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed.
Listen to me here now. In your reading, you're talking about sign between me and the children of Israel. Sign between me and Israel and all that kind of a thing. So how is it that we have come into this? Which door we walk through to come into this?
A very fitting question.
Great question. So when you look at it, you see, the Sabbath, the day of rest,
yes,
is a sign of sanctification. Mm-hmm. Put it this way, God set his people apart. So, when you want to know you see, God believes in worship. We must worship God in spirit and in truth. Mm-hmm. And so, therefore, without a sign, you don't know where you're going. But when you have a sign, it tells you where you are from, like where you are and where you are going. Mm-hmm. That's the Sabbath. The Sabbath is telling us that God is the creator. You understand? He redeems us, he sanctifies us. And there's a blessed day coming that we are going to meet him and we are going to live with him forever. So he said to Israel that this is a sign that we are in a relationship together. That is a sign. We are in a relationship. And I want to say to you that, you know, the Sabbath is still a sign that you belong to God.
Thank you for saying that and for that nice little explanation you gave to us about the signpost and telling you where you're going. And I'm sure that Elder Morris can say more about that too. But in saying more about that, I still want you to answer the question I asked. How we walk to this?
Exactly.
When you were talking about, you know, the children of Israel.
A very good point. Because how would, as I said, we walk into it, the 21st century generation?
Yes.
Spoke to Israel. It started out in verse 12, and the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, we look back where the Sabbath was instituted. We see that in Exodus is a reminder. We see for the Bible now, it is instructions for every generation. Mm-hmm. Means that even if an example is given here, it means now that whoever comes after spiritual Israel, I would put it,
it would now be speaking to us and be relevant to us, because Sabbath now, according to Mark 2, verse 27 to 28, would have been for mankind. Not mankind for it, but for mankind. And mankind here means, as Genesis 1, 26, 27, male and female. So wherever we find ourselves, so even though this was specifically being spoken to Moses for the Israelites, it's leave no examples for us as humanity. I hope I would have explained it
yes,
as best
and,
as
and
I could.
I hope that we do believe in the Bible. That's why we are doing the Bible study.
Yes.
And the Bible tells us in straight language that if ye be Christ,
mm-hmm.
then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise.
Right.
So that our adoption is a sure one into this
we are
complete
right.
family
we are
of humanity.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
And it's a sign, as you said, that it is a sign, God declared that it's a sign between the children of Israel forever. But we, as you said, that we are adopted into the family of, into the Abraham seed.
That's
so
right.
We are spiritual Israel.
And we adopted are, by acceptance.
That's right.
Yes. Not yes. rejection.
Yes.
So even though the meal is ready to be eaten, if it is not eaten, even though presented before us on a table, on a yes. platter, on a plate, it's not eaten, guess what? We still reject it. So we have to accept it by eating it. God after salvation. And there brings us that rest.
Yes.
So if we don't accept the rest, if we don't see it as a sign, a memorial, so each week becomes so special. I'm just bringing a little bit of summary all here and there.
I'm glad you're putting the summary there, because I was just waiting on you to stop and then say, give me your final thought.
Oh, okay.
So let it be.
Okay. So this will be my final.
Right.
If we don't really accept God, see his Sabbath as a memorial, as him being our creator, as relaxing, then it become burned. Because honestly, Pastor, if we just see the Sabbath as even beginning in the morning, if we don't see, we have studied in the past, as it's from sunset to sunset. And so if we start seeing it as that moment where I am now allowing God to guide me, and I'm fellowshipping with brothers and sisters, my friends, I'm doing good, and so I'm relaxed. At the end of the Sabbath, I can say, hey, this was a day of celebration. This was a day of joy. I did not do anything that I want to do, but I did things that was led by godliness. And so each week that we experience this rest, it brings us closer to God.
Thank you so much. Your final word, Pastor?
The Sabbath rest is to remind us where God has brought us from.
Amen.
But it also helps us to minister to those in our midst.
Yes.
To touch lives. And it also reminds us that, listen, one of these days, we are going to be with our Savior.
Amen.
Gentlemen, thank you so much for your input in this beautiful study that we have had.
Yes.
And I suppose this little statement here will just underscore what you have said and what we have studied for the period of time, where it says God's Sabbath is a constant reminder of our origins,
yes.
our liberation, our destiny,
yes.
and our responsibility to the outcasts and the marginalized.
Yes. Amen.
To our viewers, I would just like to say, I hope that you have enjoyed the study with us. As we talk about Sabbath rest in the context of rest in Christ, and in the overall context of the kind of world in which we live, and how we badly need rest at this time, how we are harassed here, there, and everywhere, physically, mentally, spiritually, every way. I just hope that you will learn, as we go through these studies, that from the creation, God had us on his mind. And he still has us there, and he's taking care of us. Depend on him. And we are saying to you, plan to share time with us next week as we go into the Bible study hour again. Develop a love for studying God's word, because we get comfort and consolation from studying God's word. And May God bless you sincerely as you go through the week till we meet again next week for the Bible Study Hour. We pause here to say thanks again to our sponsors, Easy Deal Auto Sales and Tours Limited, located at 1139 Catherine Hall, Montego Bay. And we say thanks to all those who have made it possible for us to reach to you with this very special study this week. We say thanks, chief of all, to God, our Creator, our God, Lord of the Sabbath, Lord who has promised us real, true rest. We ask you now to join us in our closing prayer.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for this opportunity of sharing. Forgive us of our sins. We thank you, God, for allowing us the inspiration. We pray, Lord, that those who listen will be blessed. We will continue to have a closer walk with you. Continue to guide our minds. Continue to direct our thoughts. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen. Amen.